Divinities, blessed immortal Atman, children of the Divine, sadhaks upon the path of spiritual sadhana, seekers seeking the reality which ever shines, ever present, behind the obscuring veil of temporary names and forms, temporary appearance of this phenomenal process. Yogis engage in the task of yoga sadhana to pierce beyond this veil of appearance of Maya and attain the reality. First comes vichara, then comes viveka, and through vichara and viveka there flowers forth vairagya. Vichara is stimulated by careful observation of life around us. We simply do not allow events and occurrences to pass without observing it carefully, without reflecting over it. What is it I am reflecting? What is its significance? What is its deeper meaning? Does it hold any special lesson for me or some unspoken message? Thus, the observer does not become merely eyes only seeing, but he becomes a thoughtful observer, and he becomes an active inquirer, vicharavan, of what is being seen and observed, and tries to find out the deeper significance of what has happened. From every little thing, we can observe and learn something from the behavior of two children. If two children are left alone, temporarily, some lady is visiting her friend, she has come with her child, so they want to gossip in the kitchen, and children will be a distraction, so they leave the child in the children's room. Housewife, hostess also has got a little child, and it happens that only one toy there. Soon, their talk in the kitchen will become interrupted by little shrill cries screaming from ma. And what is the matter? They will go. They will find one child holding up the toy in one side and another child holding the child. And the bigger, stronger child wanting to push the other child, want to keep it. There is whole commentary on life. The behavior of elderly people, behavior of communities, behavior of nations becomes epitomized in this. Gada ko gada mile to phire mare laat. You find inside humanity also, if they are not given to supply separate to place, sometimes even that also, you see, it's like he'll want what he hasn't got. Then better than he wants that toy. That way, supposing that toy has been given to him and that has been used, then also he would have opposite, he would have wanted that, what the other one wants. In that way, if for the vicharashil, the hidden significance of outer appearances become teachers, unspoken. A poet, an English poet, has written sermons in stones and books in babbling brooks. The persons with a quickened vision, poetical eye, he says, as he walks by in the forest, going for a walk, and a lonely little stretch of forest. He does not merely pass through a forest filled with inert object. He finds sermons in stones, and he finds a whole book in babbling brooks. Though chota sa thalna bhar raha hai, to usme se he gets. And one of the things a brook says, men may come and men may go, but I go on forever. I will never leave my movement towards the ocean, twisting and turning, leaping and falling. The mountains and villages dancing, and some of the circumventing obstacles, sometimes overcoming obstacles. I go on and go on and go on until I reach the majestic ocean. In that same way, he finds a lesson in everything. Finds a lesson in everything. One poet was in his study. Monsoon was about to set, suddenly there was sky was overcast, there was wind started to blow. There was a very strong wind. Soon a storm set in, and down came rain, And he was watching in fascination. Terrible wind sweeping fields, he could see from his window. And the tall, tall corn had already grown, harvest was there about to be reaped. And suddenly he heard a shattering noise. And unable to bear the force of the wind, a tree had broken. Whereas the entire harvest bent low before the wind. Wind blew, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, then exhausted itself. And once again, when the wind stopped, the harvest once again stood straight, whereas the tree was broken. He said, look here, if you know when to yield and stuff, takarana arghanam se, akar ke, ekdam sidha na khada ho to ke, kya hota hai? The tree broke into two, whereas the corn and the leaves, that is what Zen teaches you, that is what also Judo teaches you. Don't resist power with power, but know how to heal and become untouched. In the same way, he found a profound lesson how so yielding one is able to overcome the fury and of the blast, whereas being rigid one becomes broken. In this way, observation stimulates inquiry. Inquiry creates the ability to discriminate. And through discrimination, one begins to see the difference between the mere appearance, the passing, and the permanent and the reality. And the Vairagya comes. And we saw how this faculty of keen observation, no doubt, he had to develop because he was a medical man. A physician has to observe every little symptom, whether the patient tells it or not. Sometimes you gather through questioning the patient, and sometimes you gather by mere observing the patient, looking at the patient. As the patient you question and the patient is going on telling his history, you find the patient is fidgety and restless. Even without his telling you, you know, he is a very nervous type of person, easily susceptible to any outer occurrence. So we gather some information. So keenly he must observe. And the surgeon also. My physical examinations have been old days. They did not have all these laboratory facilities and this examination, this test, that test, x-ray and 100 different things, which ultimately leave the patient so impoverished, he is unable to pay the doctor's fees after the disease is cured. It is said after heart operation, the patient asks the fees. Nowadays they have all got rates, everything is got rates. But then in those days, the doctor did the treatment and afterwards collected his fees. He asked the operation. Then doctor said, it appears, well, should I tell you, it may give you a shock. And no, you can tell me, doctor. And the doctor told the fees. And then the patient asked, may I tell you something, doctor? Yes, but it may give you a shock. No, go ahead, tell me. He said, doctor, I am bankrupt. So, doctor, I had a collapse. In this way, this is something which sometimes happens between doctor and patient. But anyhow, The doctor has to be keenly observant, and the surgeon or the physician, they were able to find out by questioning and by observing and what a certain symptom meant immediately, try to know the reason behind, the cause behind this symptom, all these things. So the medical profession makes a person very keenly observant and very subtle in detecting the cause behind certain apparent symptoms. And young Dr. Kuppaswamy of Malaysia was abundantly endowed with these innate qualities, which when they were applied in the spiritual field became very valuable to him, became very helpful to his spiritual unfoldment, to his sudden ability to grasp the actual reality of things in this world. Sometimes Gurudev used to write, telling especially young aspirants, you must be very correct, very punctual, very regular, and very rigidly discipline yourself. Otherwise, it is not an easy joke. You cannot attain the highest realization by an easy going, happy go lucky type of easy going temperament. No, that will not do no good in this. Have you not noticed how correct, how strict, how disciplined soldiers are in the army? If they belong to some battalion or some unit and they have to stand on parade, each soldier is expected to be absolutely spick and span. And so soldiers have to do brushing of the shoe, polishing the shoe themselves. And they must, each button in his uniform must be reflecting the sun. And it should be shining bright. And if some button is dull, if the officer comes inspection, inspecting the parade, immediately he'll, what's the matter? Why is it not clean? And then immediately he'll put him into quarter guard, he'll have to do fatigue duty. So, therefore, because of that, they are always fighting fit and absolutely trim and clean and neat and tidy, because they are drilled into this sort of correctness, precision, this training. When an ordinary soldier in an army is required to be so disciplined, so correct and so punctual and regular in this, what to say of you? Even 10 times more strict, regular, punctual, correct, spick and span, well disciplined. A spiritual aspirant has to be. Soldier's goal is merely to fight and try to win a battle or a war. Whereas aspirant has to assault the kingdom of heaven, win Kaivalya Moksha. Therefore, never give leniency to your mind. You are always here. In the habit of telling you, never give leniency to your mind. And when he said that, 100% impact of it was upon the hearer. 100% impact. From tomorrow one could be no longer what he was yesterday after hearing that. Why? Because Gurudev, when he gave this instruction, one could clearly see he gave it with a firm conviction of his own practice. His own practice. Sadhana ke baare mein jo bhi Guru Maharaj sadhakon ko kaha karte the, wo apna swayam anubhav ke aadhar par wahi cheez, wahi sadhana unhone खूब अपने आप अभ्यास करके, थोड़े समय तक नहीं, खूब अभ्यास करके, तो उनका स्वभाव बन गया था। उसी बातों को उन्होंने साधकों को, अपना शिष्यों को बताया करता। सो इट कैरीड कन्विक्शन, इट फोर्स बिहाइंड इट, because the hearer immediately felt in his heart, here is someone who is saying what he himself has gone through. He is not giving us some, imparting some theoretical knowledge, he is giving a part of his life. That was the power behind Gurudev's word, in spite of the fact that he seldom really, gave such straight direct messages. Rarely. See, once in a while. Because he always used to say, anyone who has come to Anand Kutir, anyone who is living in Shivananda Ashram, if he complains about the lack of guidance and all that, he is a lazy person. He has no interest in his own welfare. Why, Swamiji? I have given everything that is necessary for a sadhana. I have given it in my hand, 300 books. See? If once you are seriously interested in yourself, you will go through this book, study my books. Then you will have no doubt. Then you will never have any hesitation in proceeding upon spiritual sadhana. I have given everything that is necessary for a spiritual aspirant. And therefore study. After a sincere study, if you have got any doubt, any questions, come and ask me. So it was 100% correct. If anyone with real interest took the pains to go through the hard labor he had put into his own writings, then there will be absolutely a clear path ahead of him. For every question there was an answer. And therefore it was that General Sharma told him he is a man of, a sage of practical wisdom. Gurudev, both, many people regarded Gurudev as personification of Gita teachings, embodiment of Gita. They said, if you want to see a sthita prajna, go to Rishikesh, go to Swami Shivanandi, the Godman. And some of his teachings even puzzled veteran sannyasins and spiritual leaders of Rishikesh, Haridwar, etc. But Gurudev never speak of himself. He seldom spoke of himself. I have known only on one occasion, one insistent young man succeeded in making Gurudev speak about himself. And he yielded to his constant pressure because he had a soft corner for this young man because of his having great regard for his guru. A lean man with only a white dhoti and a white towel on his shoulders. And he came in summer and lived here for about a year and a half. Throughout winter his dress was only white dhoti and white towel. Titikshu, youngster, health was good I suppose. South Indian, all the way from Madras he has come here. But no persuasion of Gurudev could make him wear a banyan on his shirt. Seturaman, I think he was called. So, he being the understudy of a journalist, he had that probing mentality inborn within him. And he had hardly been about 3 or 4 months in ashram. He started pestering Gurudev with questions about him, his sadhana, his experiences in Malaysia, his early life in the Tamrabhani banks at Pattamale, went on going. Gurudev, by that time already 2 or 3 biographies of Gurudev had already appeared. One was by no less than a personality than Swami Paramananji himself. Swami Paramananji wrote the first biography of Gurudev called Swami Shivananda. It was, the very first edition was printed at Madras by P.K. Vinayagam of My Magazine of India office. Second edition was later on enlarged with many illustrations. It was printed by Ram Nivas Gupta, his father, venerable father. It was printed by Babu Kashiram Guptaji of Calcutta. General printing was Calcutta. Profusely illustrated. Paramahanji was the author. And another book called Sage of Ananda Kutir was written by a Delhi advocate called Sri Dwarkanath Jingham. Dwarkanath Jingham, he was a disciple of Guru Maharaj and very serious, very staid, very dignified gentleman, very, very man of few words. He had written this biography. So when he was pestering him too many questions, he read, "Oh, read Dwarkanath Jingham's book, Sage of Ananda Kutir, read Paramahansa." But this young man was not satisfied. He said, "I have read everything, but I want to know specific questions, interrogation." So ultimately, suddenly, Gurudev decided to humor him, and then he started giving him some information, talking about himself sometime. Gurudev in those days used to come up for a walk in the evening. Especially it was a sight to see him coming up for a walk in summer evenings, because he couldn't bear the heat. He loved to be on the banks of the Ganges because the breeze blowing over the waters was like AC. It was like air conditioned. He liked to sit right on. But before that, he used to come up. He used to come to the office. At that time, the office was a present post office. Only that much room, present post office. He entered the post office from the Ganges side, stepped in, and immediately to the left hand side of the door was a small sofa. I don't know, Paramahansa had preserved that sofa for a long time. I don't know what happened, where it is now. It was part of the regalia. Small sofa. Just enough for Gurudev to sit. It was a sofa. People like me or two or three people could sit. But Gurudev filled the sofa completely. And then, so back was towards the Ganges wall. No window that side. Only on the other side, right hand side of the road, there was one window. And when I first came here, in the office there used to be only one person. There used to be a short Swamiji belonging to the Avadhuta Parampara of Dattatreya. And he was not a fully initiated Avadhut. He was called Brahmachari Purna Bodh. If he had lived long enough, he would have got the appellation Swami Purna Bodhendra Saraswati. Purna Bodhendra Saraswati. They came from a Parampara which is near Salem, which is called Sendamangalam, where they what is known as a Avadhuta Dattatreya Guhalayam. And his guru was a very famous Avadhuta in those parts. Yes, they are from that Sadashiva Brahmendra Parampara. And Swami Purnabodh, he was the only person in India. He was a cashier, he was a typist, he was a jack of all trades. If he stood by Gurudev, he could perhaps come to Gurudev's waist only. He used to be there, and Gurudev came and sat there. And if visitors came, they had to sit on the floor with a little table between Gurudev and themselves. And Gurudev was very careful not to allow anyone to touch his feet. He never allowed anyone to do pranam touching his feet. And therefore there was a cloth which went down to the floor from the table, a cloth that reached the floor. And yet I have seen some persistent Punjabi ladies put their hand inside the floor and try to father sparsh. And at that time Gurudev would retract as far as possible his legs. And then, in the daytime, in summer, his schedule was very, very extraordinary. Summer was terribly hot, winter was terribly cold in those times. In summer time, his morning office hours was 6 to 7:30. By 6 o'clock he was in the office. By that time it was bright sunlight. Sun had come over the western mountain. And why? Because he wanted to go back before it became too hot. So he came at about 6 o'clock. By that time he had finished his bath in the Ganges, and tall figure with a stick and a very thin dhoti. It was borderless dhoti, it was just thin cloth. What they used to call Glasgow mal, they used to call it. Mal. He wore only that. And a small Murdavadi towel. See this red towel or a green towel, this little towel. We sometimes give it Harijan Pujadi and Gamcha. And he used one Gamcha to hold this dhoti in place. He tied it like that, because he had a very rubbery type of body and belly, you see, and so the dhoti always could slip away down, and so he secured it with one gamcha, and with the other gamcha on the shoulder he used to come and sit in the office, and someone had to keep fanning, otherwise he'll perspire very easily. And so 6 to 7.30, latest 8 o'clock, sun started becoming hot, went back to his kutir. And kutir, now we wonder how he lived in that kutir. That kutir, by 9 o'clock, he could not step out of his kutir without padraksha, something, sandals, because the kutir veranda was a bare platform. Bare open platform with nothing between it and the sky. See, all the 12 months it was open to the sky. If it rained, the platform became drenched. If it poured, the platform became burning hot. See? And it was just cement platform. And there was no roof of any kind. That L along the Ganges and then turning the side, that was a bare open platform. And his immediate sailor, as soon as we came down the steps, we crossed the platform, immediately Sevak used to live in that room. So they went round and entered his room. And his system was, he only went as far as the other side of the platform. His Sevak went into the first room. Gurudev opened his kutir, went and closed it from inside. And no one could enter his kutir, even the Sevak could not go there. Until Gurudev opened, unbolted the door and say, Om. At that time he did not use any bell or anything, Om. And so he came out and after 2 hours went back. Morning. Again he came in the afternoon. And in summer times he came at about 5:30 or so, 5:30 or 6. By this time he used to come. Then it was also blazing hot. Sit in his and the entire dark of that day, when the dark came, one of the Swamis went to Rishikesh and brought the dark on his shoulders, because there was no post service at that time. And the dark was brought from there and given to Gurudev. But there used to be what is known as a branch post office, which was manned by one senior Swami called Bakhanavala Swami. And the letters, the bag was brought from there. And Gurudev's letters were handed over to his secretary. His secretary at that time when I came was also called Swami Krishnananda. And his name, his mother tongue also was same as Krishnananda Swami's mother tongue. And you can think about the volume of correspondence. When the correspondence came round about midday, when Gurudev came in the evening for his evening office to meet visitors and see that day's letters, the Swami brought the letters together with the typed reply also and kept it before Gurudev. and nobody has to read it. They are in en rapport with the Gurudev, you see. Then you exactly, sometimes people distinguish the language of Gurudev and they, and you go to them, and if you wanted to add something, you would add a couple of lines in his green ink pen. And so, it was posted the next day. So, that was the volume of correspondence. Dark came in the morning, by that time Gurudev was already in Scooter. When he came in the afternoon, letter, reply, everything was already there. Very rarely have I seen him send back a letter and say, retype it again, write like this. Very rarely. And then after the afternoon office was over, he majestically climbed the hill and came up just to see what was going on here. 3/4 of the entire this area was forest. It was, and out of the forest, 80% was bale trees. 80% was bale trees. And baki 20% was some jungle trees. And there was no way, where we have big cement steps now, there was no way. The only way was where the car is now coming. So he had to walk. He came along the banks of the Ganga, came past Ramashram Dharmashala, and there was a steep climb to the road there. From Ramashram Dharmashala, steep climb to the road, and the road was going past the arch by the side of the hospital. The Rishikesh Devaprayag Badrinath road went past Akhilanandamma's room, that is Ganesh Kutir. That was the road, and then past the arch and just past the hospital, under the floor of the reception, previous reception room. And then it continued in that level right up till past Darshan Mahavidyalaya, and it was very steep in line. So he had to come via that road, Ramashram, climb the Ramashram, come into Ramashram Dharmashala side from his office. There was no communication in between. And it was all mountainside, and then came along that road, and the climbing started somewhere below where our Chaukidar, old Chaukidar, has brought his Ramprasad, yeah, where his shop is. Below it, the climb for the upper ashram started, and it was only a footpath, zigzag footpath. So he used to carry his hill stick always. He used to come and see what construction was going on. Previous year, Bhajan Hall had just been completed. Bhajan Hall had just been completed. Vishwanath Mandir was not started. And the only building that existed at that time was Yogasavarakuti. The first ever line of rooms were built. Four rooms were built. Later on, one room was added to that end, steps end, another room was added at this end. Slightly bigger in dimension. And four rooms in the press building that existed. And then where Master Satchidananda Maitaneji and Surya Damanji are living, those two rooms existed. That were Bhajan Hall, those two rooms, three rooms in the press block and Yogasavarakuti. They were the rooms upstairs and then jungle. And so, the mandir was in the process of being built, and for everything you had to go a steep footpath only amongst trees. And then he used to come, take a look at the mandir, speak a few words to the masons, Kaisa Sarkaraya. At that time, it was war time, and everything had to be got by permit. But here we had no difficulty, not much difficulty, because it belonged to Teri Garhwal Darbar. And so, we had only to go to Narendranagar. And then after that, after inspecting, it would come down. And that was the wonderful sight to see. And majestically, by that time, if it became semi-dark, one disciple will come with a hurricane lantern just in front of him. And he will be following him majestically with his big stick. And sometimes, if we came a little early in the evening, we had more time, we went round, saw the temple construction, and afterwards, if we had still some time, he gave himself a little exercise. And exercise, it will be funny. You know, there is that bell with the ring of the Akhanda Kirtan. That always was there to call people for the satsang. And we were one of the ashrams that gave our bell, hour after hour bell. Swargashram gave, we gave from here. And at that time, Gurudev used to catch hold of that iron post and do little it's just like bus up and down. You wheel on the floor, pushing yourself, push-ups, that he used to do. And there's a film also, arrange the film. Then later on, he will gently trot from the bhajana. He would run around the bhajana. And after a little few rounds, if he became a little tired, he would walk. And it was a delightful sight to see. As he walked along, some were mosquitoes and sometimes flies also. So as he walked along, that Gamcha used to shake that Gamcha sometimes because he wouldn't hurt a fly, little. He wouldn't hurt a fly, he wouldn't hurt a mosquito, but at the same time he cannot afford to allow them to sit and sting. So, like elephants constantly switching its tail, or sometimes elephant, you see, they have a little branch of a tree in their sound and then do it. So, Gurudev used to majestically walk along and kept himself, this Gamcha used to sit along. And so, after that, he went down and when it became cold, because the platform was very hot, you know, this very hot in summer. But winter it was quite the reverse. In winter he came to the office at about 10 o'clock, 10 or 10:15, and he had to wear some warm clothing. He came and sat in the office, chatted with people sometimes 12 o'clock, 12:30, even 1 o'clock. And then he used to go to the the moment he entered, his kutir finished. Afterwards, no one had any access. Even though it was an open platform, no one dared go there. And he came back briefly for an hour, very briefly for an hour in the evening. It was short days and long nights, early sunset. He came maybe at about 4 o'clock, sat till 4:30 or 4:45. Went away to the kutir. And then sometimes he went and sat on the bank of the Ganga river, in that platform. But even though he was sitting in the open, no one could go and disturb him at that time. Then he came a third time. Those who missed him in the morning and evening, they had to meet him only in satsang. And he came in the evening satsang within half an hour after the satsang, because the kirtan bhajan was over. Then he would come and take his place, and when in those days he sat completely straight and rigid, listening to whatever was going on. Something had to be read, he would listen to, and something kirtan was going on, he would listen to. His part was only at the end, concluding kirtan. And so the whole schedule changed according to the climate, according to the season of the year. And his dress in winter also became quite different. He sometimes wore a turban. And so, this youngster managed to follow him, so summer and winter, and went on probing. Ultimately, he was able to humor him. In winter, he said, "Oh, all right. You come early in the morning. I will give you half an hour, 1 hour. to ask all the questions. So for his sake, he started coming here at about 4 o'clock in darkness with a torchlight, sit in the bhajana, close all the doors and windows. There was no Akhanda Kirtan at that time. No Akhanda Kirtan, bhajana was only for satsang. So the boy came with the pen in the, pencil in the notebook. And he started playing with his questions. And he would give answers. And sometimes he had to think deeply and give answers. Because he had forgotten, towards some of the effects from his mind, it was not there. Yeah. And sometimes, once he caught the trend, no more questions were necessary. He would go on typing for half an hour. And this man had to write. And Krishna Priya Paras Mataji may know, there is a book called Saint Shivananda. Saint Shivananda, a tiny little book called Saint Shivananda. That was one of the first books that were written after the first two biographies by Paramahansa and Dwarkanath began, Seja Paramahansa Kutir. Until that there was no and this man, this youngster, each day, whatever he jotted down, he wrote it out in fair and gave it to Guru Maharaj. And thus he started speaking about himself. Otherwise he never spoke about himself. And yet I have seen some very big mahant in Haridwar wanting to know about Gurudev's peculiar behavior. Swamiji, aap to शंकर परंपरा के दशनामी सन्यासियों में से है. सन्यासी जो चलता फिरता नारायण है और सन्यासी जो आशीर्वाद करना है, आप नमस्कार करना नहीं चाहिए. और ये तो एक बात है, तो भगत लोग आते हैं, चेले लोग आते हैं, नमस्कार किया तो आप आशीर्वाद करना चाहिए. आप तो उल्टा आशीर्वाद नहीं करते हैं, वो नमस्कार करने के पहले आप उनको पैर छू करके नमस्कार करते हैं. ये तो हुआ, तो हमारे मर्यादा के खिलाफ है ये इसका. देन देयर वाज अ हिंदी स्पीकिंग स्वामी, ए वेरी फायरी यंग स्वामी जी, हु यूज्ड टू बी ए जर्नलिस्ट इन अ कांग्रेस वर्कर ऑफ बिहार. ही वाज वेरी साइड. ही ट्राइड टू एक्सप्लेन इट टू हिम दैट गुरुदेव विजन इज डिफरेंट. महंत सिद्ध, नो, वो तो ठीक है, लेकिन आपके मुख से हम नहीं चाहते. आई वॉन्ट टू हेयर फ्रॉम स्वामी जी. एंड वेन ही कॉर्नर्ड स्वामी जी एंड वेंट ऑन क्वेश्चनिंग स्वामी जी, एक्चुअली इट वॉज आफ्टर ही हैड ऑलमोस्ट फोर्सिबली किडनैप्ड स्वामी जी. ही केम ऑन वन विजयादशमी डे, सडनली केम. ही वॉज वन ऑफ दोज very rich mahants of Haridwar. In those early days, he was one of the few people who had a motor car of his own. So he came in his car and Gurudev was just opening some little exhibition or something, and after that he was relaxing and talking and asking questions about some items of the exhibition and all that. At that time suddenly this man came, a very burly and thick-set man. But panting and panting, he came up the hill. Because at that time, coming up the hill and going down was both a difficult task. It was a very narrow, steep footpath going via what is known as Parvati Kutir and Shiv Kutir and Piyav, and then only it went into the road. As I told you, the road was about 10 feet at least below the present road, 10, 12 feet. And so he came, Swamiji, and aapko le jaane ke liye aaya hai. डियर फ्रेंड, हम नहीं आता. कैसा नहीं आते हम ना, लेके मैं जरूर जाएगा, नहीं छोड़ेगा आपको. इसे देन ड्राइवर थी रिकॉर्डमेंट थी क्या बना, पूरा योगा वेदांत यहाँ पर दर्शन प्रदर्शन किया. ही वाज ऑफ द इंटरेस्ट, ही वेंट ऑन. हाँ बहुत बढ़िया है, बहुत बढ़िया है. एंड बैक ही केम टू द सेम सेशन. अब जो हमारे साथ चलना पड़ेगा. गुरुदेव से तो नहीं, नहीं नहीं, हम आपको उठा देते, हम गाड़ी ले आए, गाड़ी में बैठा करके ले जाएगा. अजी हम अकल नहीं आ सकता, इमीजिएटली वन स्टेप डाउन कर लेके अकल नहीं आ सकता, नहीं ना हमेशा और एक गाड़ी में मंगवाएगा इसी के से टैक्सी मंगवाएगा आपसे। सो थ्री और फोर ऑफ अस हैड टू गो भाई बिकॉज वी स्टे दैट डे, ही मेड अ स्टे दैट डे इन हरिद्वार भाई बिकॉज ही वॉज बिल्डिंग ए ह्यूज संस्कृत विद्यालय इन विच only sadhus, brahmacharis and sannyasis would be taught Sanskrit, because he had seen that many sannyasins and sadhus, they take sannyas and all that, they don't know Sanskrit and they cannot recite Gita and all that, so he wanted them to. So it was called Akhila Bharata Sadhu Mahavidyalaya, he called it Akhila Bharata Sadhu. So the building was almost 95% complete. So he said ये इसमें अखिल भारत साधु विद्यालय में सबसे पहले आपका पैर पढ़ना चाहिए, तब इसका आप जय हो जाएगा। इसलिए ही वॉन्टेड दैट गुरुदेव स्पीड शुड कम अपॉन दी है, सो पदार्पण के लिए ही फोर्स गुरुदेव, ही हैड नो चॉइस, ही वाज फोर्सफुल पर्सनैलिटी आल्सो एंड ही टुक गुरुदेव एंड वी हैड अबाउट कपल ऑफ आवर्स इन हरिद्वार। एट दैट टाइम ही टुक गुरुदेव टू a mandir which his sanstha owned. It is called Shravana Jnan Mandir. Shravana, it is one of the beautiful Shivalayas. Very few people know about it because it is in between Harkipari and the rest of Hardwar, Gauhat, on the inner road, not on the outer road. It is close to the Ganga canal. Shravana Jnan Mandir. He had a big library also, reading room and all that, dispensary. Very progressive type of Mahant. He was called Mahant Shantanam. And then he asked, and this other Swamiji tried to, he did not listen. He says, Swamiji ka hi hai, mukh se aana chahiye. And then when Swamiji cornered, he told, Dekho ji, wo hum sanyasi hai, hum sadhu hai, ye theek hai, लेकिन हम वेदांत हिंदी है और आप तो गीता तो पढ़ा है ना, तो गीता में जगत के बारे में क्या ज्ञान दिया है भगवान? नहीं महान जी, आप गीता का 11वां अध्याय पढ़ो, गीता का 11वां अध्याय पढ़ो और वो वेदांत का अंतिम अनुभूति क्या है, वेदांत का सबसे उच्चतम उपासना क्या है, अंतिम सर्वम खल्विदम ब्रह्मा, देयर इज नॉट मेनी, देयर इज ओनली वन, सर्वम खल्विदम ब्रह्मा। तो फिर क्या वेदांत का केवल रखने के लिए है? देन आफ्टरवर्ड महान स्टार्ट क्वेश्चन, ही नेवर क्वेश्चन द गुरुदेव एंड हिज डिसाइपल आल्सो वंडरिंग, एंड देन आई डिस्कवर्ड दैट गुरुदेव न्यू इनफ हिंदी टू कैरी ऑन सच टाइप ऑफ फिलोसॉफिकल कॉन्वर्सेशन, एंड दिस वॉज the way in which you can say he taught us, not by telling but by doing, but by doing, and that was a world of a teaching. These two sentences exchanged by these two great he was a karmad mahatma, he was a social leader, he was also in the RSS, he was in so many sanstas and all that, अध्यक्ष ऑफ दिस, अध्यक्ष ऑफ दैट, एंड इन एवरी फंक्शन, सोशल फंक्शन, गवर्नमेंट फंक्शन, ही वाज इन द फोरफ्रंट, बट समहाउ ही वाज एबल टू ग्रास्प, एंड इन दैट एक्सचेंज इट वाज एन आई ओपनर टू अस, व्हाट वाज गुरुदेव सेटल्ड कन्विक्शन एंड व्हाट वाज गुरुदेव बैकग्राउंड ऑफ अनुभव एंड व्हाट वाज गुरुदेव विजन एंड अप्रोच towards life and everything in this world. And that was the way he taught us and that method of teaching is unforgettable. It will never, though you may have, there are some pictures of Gurudev sitting in eight disciples on either side, and it is all four persons only. That is four people. There is another thing also, Gurudev sitting, four people this side, four people that side. Many times he allows people to take any, and most of these photographs were Swami Paramahansa's idea. He was at the back of it. We want to have this type of photo, we want to have Shankaracharya type of photo. He made Gurudev put like that. He improvised a danda. It was not even a real danda. And then gave it into Gurudev's hands. Gurudev enjoyed it. And this was Gurudev's personality, and this was his teachings. And he also taught us that no matter what path you are following, you should not neglect the body. He used to take exercise, and he used to do that little bit, dandu baitak like thing, and also he would do a little bit of bhastrika pranayama, and he always used to say, never neglect your health. It is the root of all, for all the four purusharthas, this is the health of the real wealth. For achievement in any field of human endeavor, sound health of the physical body is necessary. Don't neglect. Don't foolish tapasya and have breakdown in your health, he used to say. Don't do foolish tapasya and don't go to extremes. Because he had gone to extremes. He had done this type of tapasya and lifelong he had to suffer for it. And so if you saw any of us in our little bravado, go and stand in the Ganges and wanting to do japa, waist deep in the water, if you happen to observe it from a scooter, he will send his personal attendant, hey, ask that man to come out. He wants to do tapasya or get lambagavanda bagi. Like that, Gurudev followed the Buddha's principle of the middle path. He was an advocate of the middle path, and he was an advocate also of the, he himself called the yoga of synthesis. He did not call it integral yoga, that was a name they used later on. Yoga of synthesis. Is karma bhakti jnana, uska a samanvay. This was Gurudev's personality, and his life itself was his teachings. His life was the highest, best teachings. His other teachings, writings and other things became secondary. Hari
ओहारमेजिशदेशमेजिशवेशमेरहो राधारमण्डाधारमण्डाधारमण्डहो जिस काम में जिस धाम में जिस गाम में रहो राधार मंडाधार मंडाधार मंडो जिस संग में जिस रंग में जिस ढंग में रहो राधार मंडाधार मंडाधार मंडो जिस योग में जिस भोग में जिस रोग में रहो राधार मंडाधार मंडाधार मंडो हाल में जिस देश में जिस वेश में रहो राधार मंडाधार मंडाधार मंडो This Gurudev did, and this Gurudev sang, and this Gurudev taught us also. All conditions, always, never forget God, always remember, constantly remember. Every moment, every breath, every step, in the midst of activity. And this is the life divine. Sajidananda Bhagavan ki jai. Sadguru Shivananda Maharaj ki jai. Shivananda Sasabdhi Mahotsav ki jai. Jai, jai, jai. Narayana, Narayana.